today, Mike said I had liberty to just preach by the Spirit. But I want to start out with prayer for the Lewises. Lord God, we just thank you for all the prayers that have been prayed, but we know this is a battle, especially for Sandra. And we just thank you, Lord God, that she will not only survive, but she will fully be restored in every way, outwardly as well as inwardly. And that even though it was a traumatic event, so one that you can't survive normally, even so, several of us have experienced those traumatic near-death, easily death experiences, but didn't happen because of you. And I believe that was due and is due to prayer. So we just want to join our prayers for Sandra and just ask you, Lord God, to bring her back completely well, so that not just so she'll be well and happy, but so that she'll be able to minister the ministry that you put in her. And you called her, and you don't call people and then they perish. You called her so she'd live and accomplish and do that which is on our heart to do. And so we know that's much more important than anything else. Is we live by every word that proceeds continually out of your mouth. Not just one word, two words, three words, but continually. And that we pray that she will live to then finish and complete the race that you gave to her. Of course, we're never afraid of death. It's just a sleep for us. But we're not afraid of that. That we just go home quicker. But that's not our prayer. Our prayer is that she live as a testimony to give hope to the faithful, that when we get into crises, which we're going to face more and more, that we're unperturbed. We're not disturbed because we have a God. We know the living God. We know you personally, not just as a religious act, but we know you intimately. And so I just thank you that Sandra has that, and that inquisitive mind that wants to be clear on everything that she can share with others, and especially her grandkids and her children. So we just thank you, Lord God, for their life and for their lives that will continue now to glorify your name. In Jesus' name we pray these things. Amen. All right, so God is good. And he can't change, thank God. So the good work he began in her and in them, he will surely, he, not us, but he will surely complete, finish. All right, today, everyone, whether they're believers or unbelievers, is worried about what's going on, not just in our country, but throughout the world. Everybody is well aware that the devil is alive and well, and he seems to be having his day. We know he's going to have a day, but it seems like it's already fairly vigorous in our day, and that it increases at such a rapid pace you can't even keep up with the unreality of how quickly our own Christian country has succumbed to the enemy, and many Christians are barely aware of what's happening, and those that are disturbed, and they shouldn't be. We should know what's going on. We should know exactly how it's going to come out, how it began, and what the answer is. We shouldn't have any problem at all. So that's what I want to share with you today. So this is going to be strong, and I'll give you a chance to read it since I don't have a type thing out or anything. I have so much that I'm doing all the time. I don't had a marriage counseling this morning and so many things. But I'll read them over and over again. I've written some up. Every problem of a social, economic, political nature in the world today, every problem is not soluble by the rulers and the leaders of our social, economic, and political world. They're not. They're not soluble. Certainly, they're not soluble by false religions. And so, all problems are deliberately, consciously, by the design of God, not soluble. He did that. He knew that he did it, and he did it deliberately so that you couldn't solve an economic problem without him. You couldn't solve a political problem without him. You couldn't solve any social relationships or problems of the family without God. And he has a right to do that, and he did it. And therefore, let men scheme away or imagine either to defy God or to help God out, it won't work. Because he deliberately made everything in such a way that you could not solve it. So I don't know if you've experienced that in your personal life, but he will give you problems that are totally insoluble by any human will or effort or whatever. You do not, like Job, you have no idea of, well, what? I don't, what you're saying is not true. I mean, I don't know what you're saying. It doesn't, it's not helping me. And God does that so that we turn to him and realize we're dependent on God. We're totally dependent on God. Does God have a right to make a world in which it depends on him? Because that's the way he did it. Totally dependent. So every problem, every trouble in the world today can be laid at, listen carefully, can be laid at and has to be laid at the door of the church. Now, what I just said is amazing, and I'll have to prove it as we go through the time, is there are no problems that are economic or political or social or personal or family or anything else that can be solved by man without God. You need God to live a godly life. But you need God to live any kind of life, anything. And though the world ignores God today, it's okay because they totally depend upon God's holiness, mercy, power, and majesty. So, every problem and trouble in the world today can be laid and must be laid to the failure of God's own people to render that worship which is due his holy name. Now, I'm going to say it again because I want you to get this, because it's my main point, that is, the Holy Spirit wants to get this across to us, is there aren't any problems in the world that can't be solved. They're all soluble. But they're only soluble if you go to where the problem is. And the problem is always and only God's people. It's only the church. And I'll point out in a little while, it's not even the lukewarm church. It's only those that are serious about God, that he's not looking to the lukewarm church to worship him, or Church of Christendom, or whatever you want to call it. He's not looking to the Buddhists to worship him. He's not. He does not even care that there are corrupt politicians or greedy businessmen or wicked actors in the world. That is not his concern. He is not going to judge that at this time. So there will come a time when he'll deal with it, but not until he deals with us first. So he's not dealing with the world today. I don't know if you've noticed that. You could kind of wonder, where's God? How come God doesn't concern about some of the awful, terrible things that are being done and are in the offing to be done soon. And everything you held dear will be shaken. Everything that you believed was a gift of God, it'll be shaken. All that can be shaken will be shaken. He said that. So right now is the shaking. And as I said, it's not even the final hours yet. It's just close. We're very close to the final hours where Israel will go through, it's got various names, but Jacob's trouble or the purifying of the sons of Levi and so on and so forth. And so that's the time when the Gentiles are still in charge and they're trampling on the courts of the people of God. So we cannot be surprised that that kind of suffering is in the world and that it isn't in the past. We'd like to read it as though, well, that happened back in the 16th century or the 3rd century or some other century, the 1st or the 2nd or something. No. Anyone who lives a godly life will be persecuted. And so, he doesn't want us just to endure or pray, God, deliver me or keep me safe during these tough times. He actually wants you to rejoice in this world when things like that happen, because you're not even dealing with the real problem when you think you're the issue or the issue is the issue. God only has one issue, worship. He wants, always has wanted, always will, and he will have true worship on this earth. And that's the only reason that he spoke to Abraham in this covenant, and later Isaac and Jacob and so on and so forth, all the way down to us. He's only calling forth the people of God for the sake of restoring the original idea he had when he created all of us. And so that the only reason he created us was so that we would worship him and serve our neighbor, love our neighbor, reach out to our neighbor as ourselves. That's it. That's the whole Ten Commandments summarized, the first and greatest commandment, and then the second, like unto it. So that's all God has ever wanted. If we do that, everything then is in order. And because it has never been, it has never been that he has had that, certainly not in Israel, but not in the church either. If you read carefully, there are always moments. There's always a hot remnant of believers who have given worship to God in any generation. There isn't a time in history where there weren't some true believers on the earth, or there wouldn't be an earth. There always had to be some for which he kept the thing going, and he knew that. And so you cannot point out a time or a place where God hasn't been interested. What is man that thou art mindful of him? But his mindfulness, all his thoughts toward us are thoughts of peace. His mindfulness and his thoughts of peace are always that we should line up perfectly with him, shalom, so that we were perfectly spirit, soul, and body lined up with God individually, and corporately, that we would worship him and love our neighbor as ourselves, serve our neighbor. And so that's why he took Israel out of Egypt, because he has a right to do anything he wants to, because that's his purpose. That was the only purpose of creation. So the whole natural world totally belongs to God. Nothing is outside his control, his knowledge, his interest, that leads to the church. And the purpose for the church is not just to get us into heaven. It's to get heaven into the pagan. And the reason he raised up Israel was to help the pagans out, but they failed. So then he called the church, and now the church has failed to bless Israel. So it looks like God has slim pickings as to what everyone keeps forgetting what his mission was. He still is after the pagans. He still loves those pagan heathen nations and wants the church to be the salt of the earth and the light of the world for those people. It's not for the church. The church is not the light for the church. You're not trying to love one another so that we'll all have light. We are corporately to love one another so that it'll benefit the world. They don't want to just see an individual or two. They would like to see whole congregations of faithful people that actually lived. And there hasn't been such a thing. It's amazing how little evidence there has been over the last 6,000 years of history, how little whole churches belong to God. There's very few. I don't know how many there are. I don't want to say there's none, but I don't think there's very many where that church was really the church. Again, I don't eliminate God's the judge, so I don't want to eliminate that there weren't some, but I don't know of very many, if there are. It's the opposite. It's the Laodicean church is more typical than all the other churches. The Philadelphia church, kind of rare, where you won't even go through the Great Tribulation because you've already done it when you loved the brethren. And that's what the church avoids at all costs. The church has avoided at all costs loving one another because that would be the death of you. The death of you would be to worship God, that's the first death, and then to serve the neighbor, that's the second death of you. I mean, there's many of them, but they kind of line up that way, is just to believe, just faith is death. To believe in God is to kill your flesh. To believe in God is to kill your flesh. And then to be a disciple of God kills your flesh. And then to be a lover of others, that kill your flesh. I think everything is designed by God to kill your flesh. And that's what worship is all about, and that's what service is all about, is so that you die to yourself and you live unto God. I'm just repeating everything that's in the Bible. It's should be a common knowledge in the churches, at least. It's not. It is not common knowledge in the churches. It's amazing. It's unbelievable that Christians don't have a clue as to what Christianity is. And yet it's written on every page. It's just there everywhere. That's why I love Mike, because he's actually teaching what people don't want to teach. They don't want to teach it because they don't want to suffer. But I can't imagine. Why wouldn't you want to suffer? If the only way you can be glorified is to suffer, wouldn't you want to suffer? If the only way you can get to chair 6 would be if you suffered in chair 5, wouldn't you want to go beyond chair 4 to get into 5 so you could get into 6 so you could go to 7? I mean, hasn't God set everything up so that you're no longer sinful and wicked? And the only reason of all those chairs is to get rid of all those sins in chair 1 and 2. And I will try to explain chair 3 is very interesting, because repentance means the opposite of what people think it means. I mean the opposite. I mean the absolute opposite. And I hope I can share that a little bit of why repentance doesn't mean at all what people think it means, even though they have the definition, or they think they do, of metanoia in the Greek and nuach, which is one of the words in the Old Testament. So every problem and trouble in the world today can be laid and must be laid to the failure of God's own people to render unto God the worship due his great name. And what that means is, when you give God the worship that's due his great name, you are surrendering your spirit, soul, and body to love the Lord thy God with all thy heart and with all thy soul and with all thy strength, and then corporately, and thy neighbor as thyself. That's a killer. That is a killer. And that's what God wants. That is called crucifying your flesh on a daily basis. You know it's in the Bible, where it says, you know, every day we should be walking in the Word. Every day we should be submitted to God, surrendering to God, so that we never say our own words, never do our own words, never will our own will, and don't have a personality that's independent of God. That our persons, and this is why you were created, is to give back what God gave you. Whatever God gave you, he doesn't make you do this. It's voluntary. He wants you to freely enter into chair 4, 5, and 6. Freely. And you might repent of sins because they're bogging you down and hurting other people and they're going to get even with you or something. So you might want to repent of all that to be maybe a chair 4, but really, God doesn't believe in chair 4. He only believes in chair 4 if it goes to chair 5, and only believes in chair 5 if it goes to chair 6, so that you can get to chair 7. So I'm using chairs as an example that everything in the Bible fits into this little sevenfold process where you go from sinner to saint. It's all. It's a process. It's not an event. It's not a one-time event. I believed in Jesus Christ 4 years ago on April the 16th, 1906 or something. It has nothing to do with that. You're not born again because you believe. You're only born again if you're born to die. I'm going to say that again so that you understood what I just said. The only reason you're born again, not naturally born, is because naturally born people can't get anywhere. They can't die to the flesh. They cannot die to the flesh. They cannot. Even if they commit suicide, they cannot die to the flesh. It won't pay for anything. But when you're born again, then you can die. So the purpose of being born in Jesus Christ, justified by faith, the whole purpose of that is so you can die. Surrender. Be crucified daily, continually, constantly. Even to the death, you won't be dead completely. You have to start this every day. It's a daily, chair 5 is a daily dying. It's a continual, constant dying. Why? Because Paul says, I die daily. So you have to die every day. Oh my gosh. So that death is the sure sign that you're a believer. That you believed in chair 4 is only proven by chair 5, where you, the minute he gave you new life, give it back to him. Give it right back to him. Lord, I don't know what to do with this new life. Could you do it? And you surrender then to his will, to his purpose, to his words, to his works, to his glory. And by rendering that worship to God and love to the neighbor, you're not ready. Even though you're in chair 5, you're still not doing it. You're only willing it. You're only willing to do it. But you haven't done it. Just because you're starting to do it doesn't mean you're finished. You're not finished till you're finished. So it's not he who begins, but he who endures to the end. You've got to go on to the very end so that you're not just born of the Spirit, chair 4, filled with the Spirit, chair 5, emptied of yourself, but also led of the Spirit because you're dead. It can't be led if you're not dead. You have to be dead to be led. You have to be dead to be led. So you have to be born, though, to die. If you're not born, you can't die. And if you're not dead, you can't be resurrected. And so the being led of the Spirit is the resurrected life, where you're actually not just a believer, chair 4, not just a disciple, chair 5, but to be a lover, chair 6, so that when men see your good works, they'll glorify your Father which is in heaven, Matthew 5, 13 through 20. So we can see that God's interest in his church is everything. And even the church doesn't pay attention to it. The church is not even paying attention to growing all the way, even though there's scriptures for all of this. The church just is only interested in chair 4. That's the end of its interest. Even when they're serious about house churches or something or other, or something more than being born again, even when they're serious about it, it doesn't mean they're really serious about it. And so this death is serious to God. He wants your death. So really your prayer every day should be, Lord, I need you to convict me if there be any wicked way in me. I mean anything, inward, outward, anywhere. Convict me. Slay me. Destroy my flesh. Let David pray that way. Create in me a clean heart. I need a clean heart, God. I got to have another one. This old heart of mine, this natural heart, not going to get me to where I need to be going. So God's purpose then is to never be focused on this world and how it's falling apart. That should never be your focus. People now will travel any distance to go and hear some minister teaching on the end times or the blood red moons or something or other, because people are so interested in the future now that their past is drying up and their present stinks. And so they're kind of interested, whoa, before we lose everything, let's find out what's coming. And so that's good. I mean, that's good. They're teachable. But I wouldn't say that's the correct way to learn. I think the correct way is to pay attention to what you already do know and act on that, rather than try to find new teachings you've never heard before from new ministers that have freshly risen up a week ago or 3 years ago or something. And so people are always looking for something novel. When this story never changes. This death thing is as old as Abraham, Adam, and as new as Jesus. I mean, it's current. It's current. So all the problems in the world today will not be solved. None of them. What God wants is your death. All right, so that's Deuteronomy 36, if you'll read that. And then, and that basically is the only positive verse in Deuteronomy, which says, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and all your soul. And it doesn't actually say mind with all your mind or strength and so on. But if you read it carefully, it does. So Jesus quotes it then when they ask him, what's the greatest commandment? Matthew 22, 37 through 40. What's the greatest commandment? And he answers correctly, and they say, yeah, you did, you said it just right. Jesus should know the Ten Commandments. After all, they're a description of him. They're a description of, you know, everything that they referred to is him. And so it's all been created for him and by him and through him and everything to honor and glorify the Son. And that's the scandal of Christianity. The scandal of Christianity is that, well, we don't mind God having the glory, which they don't give him, but we don't mind that. But we don't like Jesus getting that. He's just a man. He's just a person. We hate that idea. If you just get rid of that, we might consider being Christians. If you just get rid of Jesus. And so that scandal, I don't know why God doesn't pay attention to how people are made. Why doesn't he realize that people are, you know, they have their own opinions and ideas? You should try to work with them. But if you'll notice in the Bible, he never pays attention to people, not even his disciples. If they ask a question, that's the end of it right there. Don't ask any more than one. That's it. He doesn't want to have any discussions, any counselings, any lasting stuff. He wants to do all the talking. And he'll only ask a question to get one sentence answer, and that's it. I don't know if you've noticed that about Jesus. He doesn't counsel people, and therefore pastors are evil. I just thought I'd say that. Because you're doing something that neither Paul nor Peter nor Jesus did. He never said, I'm going to set up an hour counseling session with you, you know, next Thursday. Check with the secretary. He doesn't do it. So I don't do it. I don't counsel people. Why? Because you don't need it. Why? Because you're just wicked, that's all. And all you need to know is, have you died yet today? You know, that's all you need to know. Here's the word of the Lord. Thus, bang, over. So it takes 2 seconds, and the Holy Spirit, if you're a believer, the Holy Spirit can speak to you even before they call, and you can know they're going to call, and you already have the answer. And you have no idea what they're going to say, but you don't need to. And so just give them the word of the Lord and drop it. Any discussion after that is a waste of time.
Is that how you counsel the marriage? People and going into marriage just have to die yourself?
Yes. Yeah, I just did that this morning with a nice young couple. And you know, the first thing you tell them is marriage doesn't work without God. You know, so you're not marrying a saint. Even if they are a saint, they're not going to be perfect. And you're imperfect and they're imperfect, so that could have a problem. You could have a problem there. There could be a problem that could come up there. So if you can get past that, you're fine, you know. Anyway, so Scott can validate this, but we haven't had a divorce in our Fort Worth church for 45, whatever, years, ever, because of the counseling, which only takes a few minutes. It is. It just takes a few minutes because there's only a few scriptures. You know, you go to the Old Testament, how he creates Adam and Eve and so on and so forth. And you have one in the New Testament says, this is your job, this is her job, and something at the end where you get married to the bridegroom coming back. You know, there isn't a lot. You don't need to, I know everybody wants 1 Corinthians 13, but they're going to put that in their service anyway. So those things do not make for happy marriages. I can just tell you the kind of superficial approach we have, when the real issue is the woman should get all the blessing and the man should get all the burden. I don't know why that's hard to grasp. And so that's what Jesus did for his church. Did his church sin? Yes. Did he make her pay? No. So if Jesus treated his wife as Christ so loved the church, so let every man love his wife. It's very clear to me that it's not a complicated issue. The man is always at fault. Even if the woman is at fault, he's responsible. Because he's the head. And so therefore, marriage counseling doesn't take more than a couple of minutes. It's something very easy. Is anything goes wrong, you're the one that has to deal with it. And how many know women aren't necessarily teachable? I'm just telling you, how many know that? So the thing to do is break the man and leave the woman alone, because she doesn't have to be mature. She doesn't have to leave mother and father. He does. If a man shall leave his mother and father and shall cleave to his wife. So leave, then cleave. So the scripture is very simple, very clear, and it works. It works so well that it's unbelievable. It's unbelievable. Heaven on earth. That's the kingdom of God right there. So I gave you the Matthew 22, 37 through 40 when he was asked that question about the Ten Commandments. The Ten Commandments then, four of them, the first four refer to your worship of God. The second six refer to your service to your neighbor or your love to your neighbor. But they're summarized. Thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart and soul and strength. That's an individual. Heart, soul, and strength are individual, or heart, soul, and mind, whatever. That's an individual. But so God summarizes worship as always between the individual and God. Now, I know there's public worship. I know there's corporate worship. I know there's a community, but it's made up of individuals. And there's no way you can have a mediator, not even a body of Christ. There's no way you can have a mediator between every individual and God. And God makes that very clear. So all you have to do is kill the man. And that basically is my ministry, is to kill men. And then you don't have problems. Really. I mean, I don't know if you've figured that out, but it works good. So it's fun. I love coming here because Mike is a killer. He could kill people just really good. Because you know why? Because he's reading what the scripture says. And he's digging into it and sharing exactly what it says. And he has looked carefully at that and lives it. It is powerful. I mean, he has died because of it. He has experienced death himself over and over again. And that's powerful. That's a powerful thing. And that's all you want. How can you have a minister, someone who ministers the word, and not be dead? Otherwise, they'd be sharing their own ego and their own lust and their own greed and something else. So you have to have ministers that are dead. Otherwise, the Bible calls them hirelings. And a hireling cannot bring you anywhere because they see the wolf and flee. They see the trouble coming and avoid it. So ministers today are hirelings for the most part, and I'm not being critical. I'm just being descriptive. Most of the church today is what Mike calls Christendom, but it's just hypocritical. It's just superficial. It's religion, but it's not a relationship with the living God. It's not a love affair starting in chair 4, 5, and 6. It's not a love affair that goes on forever and ever. Okay, the church's failure to freely and fully render themselves to the Heavenly Father in true worship, both in spirit and in truth, is the first and greatest commandment. So that's the first 4 commandments. That is the failure of the church. So I want to hit today on the sins of the church. I don't want to hit on the sins of the world, the political problems or the economic problems or the social problems or religious problems. I want to hit on exactly the only thing God is interested in is not the church in general or religion in general. It's only His own people, the ones that are new creation, born again, filled with the Spirit, who then can be led of the Spirit, but often are not. But He wants you to be, and it's not hard. It's not difficult. You just have to die. I don't know why that's not difficult. So the death of the man is the key. The death of the man is the key. The church's failure to freely and fully render themselves, because you're not rendering worship, you're rendering yourselves, spirit, soul, and body, to the Heavenly Father in spirit and in truth, John 4:23. So even though that it's a verse with a few verses around it, that's the key right there. The reason Jesus came was to restore to the earth true worship. What? In spirit and in truth. They that worship the Father must worship Him in spirit and truth. Why? Because He is spirit. And those that worship Him must worship Him in spirit and in truth. That I didn't say that. He said that. That's what's missing. Do that, and everything else is yours. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and His righteousness. I'll give you everything else. That would mean you don't have a political problem. You have a worship problem. You have a worship in spirit and truth problem. You have a not being born again and going all the way with Jesus problem. That's the only thing that will produce true worship. That's the only thing that God's ever been after. And do that, and you get everything else. The minute we do that, the Jewish problem was not Jesus. The Jewish problem was they didn't obey Moses. It had nothing to do with Jesus. Well, we don't like Jesus, or we don't think He's the Son of God. That was not their problem. The Jewish problem was they didn't do what Moses said. It isn't that they didn't believe in Abraham. It's just that when they heard the law of Moses, they said, we'll do it. Instead of saying, God will do it as He promised to Abraham. Had they done that, they would be the true church of the living God to this day, and they will be. So the reason He raised us up was not for ourselves, and it isn't for all the Gentiles. It was really to help Israel to be convicted of sin. We have failed to do that. We have not only not convicted them of their sins, we have done our own sins toward them. Therefore, our message is worthless. We never figured out that we were the ones to die. We just thought we were replacing them so that, you know, now they could learn from us. No. You were to die. That's all. They're just looking for that. They know what the law says. And they know if you're doing the law apart from the law, they would know if you were doing it voluntarily apart from the law, they would know that. And when they see Christians doing that, which they do, they convert. There are many in Israel that actually are still looking at Christians thinking, I wish Christians were Christian. That when you persecute them or cause them suffering or yell at them or whatever, they love you back and forgive you. They don't see that. And so therefore, we have failed. We are the only ones God is after. God is not after anyone else but us. And by the way, you can do this all by yourself. Just to make it easy to understand, it's a singular thing, individual. If you just worship God yourself, did you know that there's great power in someone who's godly? I mean, great power. Male, female, young, old, you know, smart, dumb, fat, skinny, it doesn't make any difference, whatever the categories are. God hears the prayers of King David, an individual. But he hears the King David's prayers, because King David said, against thee and thou only have I sinned, done that which is evil in thy sight. I need a whole new life. I need a new spirit. Yeah, create a new spirit, or, you know, renew something. I'm not making it. I'm going to fall. I'm going to number or do something wrong. I just know it. And so David knew, I love thy law. The reason he loved the law was not because he kept it. The reason David loved the law was not because he kept it. He loved the law because it convicted him of sin. O Lord, if thou should mark iniquities, who could stand? David is well aware that the purpose of the law is not to make you keep it. He's well aware that the purpose of the law is to make you confess, I didn't keep it. Did y'all hear that? So Psalm 51 is powerful for that reason. It's powerful. So the church's failure to freely and fully render themselves to the Heavenly Father in true worship, in spirit and in truth, is the first and greatest commandment fulfilled. That's all God's ever wanted. And interestingly enough, if you keep the first commandment, the first and greatest commandment, notice that he didn't say, thou shalt have no other gods before me, you know, thou shalt not, you know, take any graven images and so on. He didn't say any of those. The first and greatest, he summarized all four. So this is what you owe God. Don't have other gods before me. Don't make a graven image. You know, don't take the name of the Lord your God in vain. Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. Those four are the first and greatest commandment. You keep them, you get the second. Because the second is like unto it. Love thy neighbor as thyself. So the service of God, the love of God, the fruit of the first is the second. It's the foundation and fountain of the second part, the last six commandments. So when it says the Ten Commandments, they're actually a division. Jesus didn't do the summary. They had done it long before Jesus did. They understood immediately that he gave the right answer that any Jewish rabbi could summarize also. Oh yeah, there's two commandments when there's ten. But that's because they summarized the first four and the second six. Now don't worry about the numbering. Some Protestants number it one way and some number it another way. But don't worry about all that. Just know that there's a division there. The greatest and a second like unto it. So the summaries are love God and love your neighbor. I mean, that's the summary. If you want to summarize what God has said, that's all he wants. You just do that, you'll change the world. You will change the world. And if you just do it alone, or let's say there was another one. Let's say it was you plus somebody else. That'd be a church. If two were gathered in my name, yeah, that's a church. We have more than two here today. That is amazing. So we're...
I have a question.
Sure.
Is loving your neighbor also loving yourself?
Yes. Great question, which is, thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself, meaning equally to the way I care for myself, the law of natural self-preservation. Everybody nourishes and cherishes his own body and tries to take care of himself and so on. You can't erase that from yourself. It's indelible. So God made you that way in his image and likeness to preserve yourself. But now love your neighbor that way. If you like, you know, to be treated like this, then treat your neighbor like that. And do it because you don't deserve it and he doesn't either. And so when you love your neighbor that doesn't deserve it, you are definitely hooked in with God. That proves you could not do that if you didn't worship God with all your heart and soul and strength, which kills you. You could not do that if you were still alive, a natural person.
So that's a killer right there. It is not a killer to love the neighbor, because, hey, I love my neighbor when he does what I want him to do, or, you know, as long as it's, you know, to my advantage or whatever. No, no, no. Love your neighbor as you love yourself. I know you love yourself. So it doesn't have to be selfish. As a matter of fact, it can't be. It's self-interested. You have an interest in yourself. I don't take that away. Now love your neighbor in the same way. That's all. So to love my neighbor means, how do you want to be loved? Now remember, he's not speaking to general mankind. He's speaking to believers. So if you're a believer, you should also love your neighbor till he becomes a believer. And you know, be a witness to him. And don't do it in words. Do it in the deeds, number six. So that's why God wants just Christians to be Christian. And we've confused a process with an event. Cheer 4 is not the event. It's the beginning of a process. And so this process is called salvation. This is called redemption. This threefold process is holy, holy, holy. Kodesh, Kodesh, Kodesh. But in the Greek, it's not the same word. Holy has three different words in the Greek. The first word is dikaiosune. That means it's imputed righteousness. We call it justification by faith. You actually are forgiven here, mercy, Jesus as Savior, but you're not yet set free from the sin. You still, how many know Christians can sin? I believe in Jesus Christ. I believe he died for me. I believe he rose from the dead. I believe he's at the right hand of the Father. Yeah, but if you only believe that Jesus did that for you as Savior, the blood, the mercy of God, you don't believe this, that he's actually Lord of you and wants you to submit to him, which is another killer. The first killer is to acknowledge that God exists and this is his son. That's a killer right there, because then I'm not God. That's a humbling thing right there, is to believe that all my righteousness is not from me. None of my righteousness. I don't have any. All your righteousness, the Old Testament says, a filthy rag. All of it. Well, that kind of wipes out everybody. I mean, that's a humbling deal. So if my people humble themselves, that's what he's talking about right there. This faith thing is big, but it has to be faith active. It can't be faith dead. Most Christians are faith dead. They believe, but they don't submit. Oh, yeah, I believe in Jesus as Savior. I just don't want to make him my Lord, really, actually, on a daily basis. I don't trust him there. I trust him here to have died for me. That was a good thing he did. I appreciate that a lot. And so most Christians are here in chair 4. Stop. No. If you stop right there, you'll go back to chair 1 and 2. There is no such thing as a Christian that can stay in chair 4. Within a very short period of time, you'll fall right back. You either go forward or you go back. So the church today is in trouble. Don't blame them. You're the hope. You're the only salt. You're the only light. So we don't want to waste our time judging them. You're not even a Christian. I wouldn't do that to my family. You guys are still drinking daiquiris. This is Christmas. Let's have a Jesus prayer. I wouldn't witness that way. It's not very effective, because has nothing to do with Jesus. I always put up a creche instead of a tree. But the adults weren't too excited about that. They wanted a tree, because adults grew up with that, you know. But the little kids thought it was neat. Grandpa built a complete manger in his house. So like, they were impressed that I made a barn inside of my house and with Jesus in there and, you know, whatever and so on. So they never forgot that. Hannah, the middle, my daughter one of my daughters has 8 children. And so the one day I was with Hannah, and she's just a little girl. And I showed her the manger and we were standing before it. And there was a wooden angel that I'd gotten from the Holy Land in Bethlehem. I bought that wooden angel. I had wings and it was hung up there on the top, you know, to show the angel was over the crib of Jesus. And I said, see, there's that angel there, and so on and so forth. And the next morning, she was very impressed with the candles, and everything was, you know, neat for a little kid. And the next morning, I noticed the angel was down on the floor and its wings were broken. So I thought about that. I thought, I wonder how that happened. And then I thought, well, the only one that saw it last night was me and Hannah. So I thought I'd ask Hannah, Hannah, do you know what happened to the angel? No? Okay. Well, it's broken. Look at this. Oh, she looked at it, you know, it's terrible. I said, well, somebody must have broken it because we had it. Remember how last night we were looking up at it? We had it tied up there. I said, I don't know. Okay. Well, somebody did it. I don't know who did it. Would have been, you know, there's a lot of kids in the family. Could have been anybody. And I said, do you have any idea who might have done it? Baby Jesus? I think baby Jesus might have done it. So that was her answer. It was great. It was a great answer. You have to blame somebody. Baby Jesus did that. Because he's the only other person in the room, baby Jesus. So that was good. That's good. I love it. Anyway, I never did anything. I just thought it was great. So the first four commandments produce the last six. They're the foundation and fountain of the fruit. All the fruit of the second part to the neighbor is all related to the first. So just do the first. You get the second right away. If you're worshiping God, you're dead and you're a lover. So that is so simple. It's just like, and the Jews also teach this, that if you just did the first one, you get all the other nine. Yeah, I agree with that. If you just don't have any other gods, anything between you and God, no pope, no emperor, no government, no neighbor, nobody can get in there. Me and God, he's talking to me personally. So if you just worship God alone, that's what God is looking for. And that's why America was built on that idea of the conscience being sacred, sacred piece of property. The sacred piece of property is God put that in you when you first were created by God, by his finger. He wrote that on you. Yeah.
You said in the Greek there was three different words for holy, holy, holy.
So yes. The first one was dikaiosune, from the word dike, D-I-K-E, like Nike, but only dike. That dike, dikaiosune, means it's an imputed form. So it forgives you, but it doesn't take the sin away. This one takes it away by burning you on a daily basis, causing you to suffer on a daily basis, chastising you on a daily basis, instructing you on a daily basis. No, this is fellowshipping with God on a daily basis in his word, by the Spirit, in fellowship with other believers and so on. This kind of discipleship is you become, everyone's a believer when they believe, but now you need to become a disciple, disciplined, come under authority. This one is not. This one is Jesus was under authority for me. This is Jesus working in me through the Holy Spirit, baptism of the Holy Ghost. First job, not singing happy songs, not lengthening legs, signs and wonders and miracles, not even, speaking in tongues. No, the first sign is your death. The first work of the Holy Spirit, the baptism of the Holy Spirit, is to make you holy. How does it do that? Kill you. As soon as you're dead, you will be holy. So this one is led of the Spirit because this one is filled with the Spirit, which is emptied of you. And this one is born of the Spirit. So this is dikaiosune, hagios, and doxa. Hagios then is the word for sanctification. Justification, chair 4, sanctification, chair 5, and doxa, which is glorification. This is the outer manifestation of chair 5 and chair 4. So what I believe is now active in love. Faith working through, active in love. And this is what the world is looking for. They don't see this. They never see this. They don't see your heart. They don't see your soul. They only see your body. This is all they see. When men see your good works, not when men see your faith, not when men see your will. This is the soul. Everything in the holy place, this one, that's the outer court. This is the holy place. This is the holy of holies. When men see the holy place, everything in the holy place is beaten. The flour is beaten, the grapes are beaten for the juice, grape juice, wine, whatever. The olive oil is beaten for the lampstand, on and on and on. The incense is beaten. Everything is beaten in there. The true picture of the church. The church should be the place you die. Come to church so you can die. Only he's not talking about Sunday morning church. He's talking about this kind of church, where we gather together outside the big public meeting. Why? Because the big public meeting on Sunday morning is for everybody. It's a mixture. You can come in as a witchcraft person, a Satanist. You can come in as a husband who doesn't even believe in Jesus. You know, anybody can come. But this is only for believers. When you come together in a small group like this, it's not for an unbeliever. And so this is the true church here because it's only believers, not mixed. Whereas the public church in the Catholic Church, the public church in the Protestant churches, Lutheran, Presbyterian, etc., those public churches were just Catholic churches without the Pope, without all the paraphernalia. But they were still Catholic churches because they included everybody in the parish. They included everybody who lived in a certain area. In other words, everybody had to be a Christian in Europe. Everybody. And if they were under Queen Elizabeth, everybody had to go to the Anglican church because that was her church. And if they were in, you know, some other place, maybe the prince was a Protestant, okay, everybody in his little area had to be Protestant. The next guy over might be Catholic. Well, everybody had to be Catholic. And that was the law. That was the law. You had to do it or else. And you could be killed. You could be killed if you met independently like this. But in fact, this is the kind of church Jesus actually created. The public meeting is to celebrate this with unbelievers in it. You're mixed. You have no idea who the people are next to you because you can't disciple people in a church of 2,000 people. I mean, it's not even feasible or practical. Or 400 people or even 100 people. You still don't know. But if you have 20, 30 people or 40 people or something like that, or even you could have more, but it's just a small in a house, well, then you could know everybody. Everybody, you know who everybody is. And you don't just have people coming and going like house churches are today. They're just social gatherings for ice cream and stuff, and people stay in church because of that. You know, say, yeah, this is a nice church. I went to it. I'm a Buddhist, but, you know, they had good ice cream, and I had a good time. Well, that's just retaining membership or gaining new members in a false way because they wouldn't like your church. But they don't mind meeting in somebody's home. So it's just, that's not at all what the early church was. There were only believers gathering together for one purpose only, and that is to kill all the sin in your life. Is the only purpose of it. Whatever fellowship you had, there was no organs, there was no fancy liturgies, it was simple, just like it is here. So it's just how serious are the believers there to go all the way? Well, if the minister doesn't believe in it, you're not going to go anywhere. You at least have to have the minister who himself is all the way, otherwise he can't teach. You can't teach what you don't have. So if you're only a believer and you're not a disciple, you couldn't disciple anybody else. Or if you're only a disciple but not a lover, you couldn't teach anybody else. So you have to have matured. Every man mature in Christ, Colossians 1, 28. Every man mature in Christ, it means everybody who starts out here has to then go here, has to then go here. So every man mature in Christ means perfect, or teleo, which means finished. Jesus said, when the disciple is fully taught, he shall be like the master. So when you're fully taught, that would be here, chair 6. So if you're on the way, that's okay. Stay there as long as you want to. But keep moving in this direction. You know, and a lot of pastors can't do that. They can't keep the people here because they'll fall back and so on and so forth. So you have to, you know, and they try to make covenants and all. I don't do any of that. I don't believe in that kind of thing. It's not in the New Testament. It's a voluntary thing. This is voluntary, this is voluntary, this is voluntary. You can't make people sign up and I swear, that's silly. You're just talking about people. This is done by preaching the Word of God and having signs and wonders and the action of the Holy Spirit to convict men to go on. How many know love is attractive? This is very attractive when you see this kind of love taking place in a marriage or in a family or in a church. It's very, very powerful. But that's the way the church should grow, the way Jesus set it up. You can't change it. The next thing then is that since the Ten Commandments are fundamentally connected, first part and second part, every individual born-again Christian, every single individual born-again Christian, you, often fail to go on to perfection, Hebrews 6:1. So Hebrews 6:1 says, let us go on to perfection. You know, then it lists six different teachings that are baby. That's all. Do you believe this, and this? You know, it's repentance and faith and so on and so forth. Well, yeah, but those are all juvenile. That is all kindergarten. That is all chair four. But let us go on to perfection means 5 and 6. So let us go on to perfection. That's a big thing. So every born-again Christian believer should not fail, but they often do, to go on to perfection. Why? Because the minister doesn't believe in it himself. Maybe he tried it and the people rebelled against it, so he quits. I don't. I just keep killing until I get some men dead. And women love it. They love to have their men dead to this world. So I like doing that. I always tell the men that. I never apologize for it. You have come to submit to me as the authority, and you're free to go at any time, though. There's no problem. But I'm going to kill you. That's all there's to it. So if you don't want to be dead, then you don't want to come. But they always come. And because you know what? After they see the results in chair six, they go, I want my family to be like that. And I tell you, you see a family that's in order, in divine order, it's very powerful. It's very powerful. People even on the street can see, you're Christians, aren't you? Because they can tell how the kids are behaving. And they can see how the husband and wife respect each other, love each other. I mean, all these things are real. The Bible is not theoretical. It's real. It should work. The kingdom of God should actually be here on the earth. Not perfect, but being perfected. I think you were praying that earlier. And I like that. Being perfected. They are believers, the ones that are Christians but not going on. They are believers in the mercy of Christ as Savior, chair 4, because he shed his own blood on Calvary for them, which is, by the way, what Mike teaches as the first part of the atonement. So the first part of atonement is chair 4, the first part of the atonement. The second part of the atonement are these two chairs. So you could say part A and B of the second part, but I don't care how you do it, whether you say it's 3 or 2. The point is that this then takes you to this. So the first part is what Jesus did for you, then in you, then through you. And however you do it, he uses two parts to the atonement. And that's great with me. But it's just a matter of understanding how that second part has two subparts, this one and then this one. And sometimes he'll say justification, sanctification, glorification. That's in the Bible. You can't be 6 without 5. You have to go through suffering in order to get to glorification. Unless you suffer with me, there are 10, 15 scriptures that are explicit. Unless you suffer with me, you can't be glorified with me. Very simple. So your death is the key to your resurrection. But you have to be born, then die, then resurrect. How many know you cannot resurrect unless you're dead? You can't resurrect a person that's alive. So I don't know if you've tried to renew somebody that's a believer. They're already a believer in chair 4, but you can't resurrect them because they didn't die. So you got to kill them before you resurrect them. So they're resurrected by the Holy Ghost because they're killed by the Holy Ghost. He's holy. That'll kill all the flesh in you. Holy and flesh don't live together. Have you ever seen that? If you're in the flesh, you're not going to like worship. If you're in the flesh, you're not going to be loving your neighbor. So The first thing we have to do after you become born again is get you killed so that your flesh is gone. And it doesn't mean it's gone, gone, gone. It's not gone, gone, gone. It's still there. But it doesn't rule over you anymore. You still can tell a lie, but you can't be a liar. You still could get angry, but you can't stay in the anger because the Holy Ghost is going to convict you. As soon as you become angry, the Holy Ghost is going to convict you. Why? Because you're not just born again. You're also being filled daily with the Spirit. You're in the Word. You're meditating. You're confessing. You're doing all the things that Christians do to grow in the Lord. So what God wants is a dead people. And that's why I say King David's a killer. He's a good one. I like David.
I'm sorry. I'm still going back to neighbor.
Yeah, that's okay.
Neighbor, does that mean also your fellow believer who's a friend in Christ? Or does that mean basically someone else?
That's a great question. Neighbor would be inclusive of fellow believer, of the lost and hopeless people, but also your enemy, all three. So when you love, it's indiscriminate. But there's a difference between the church loving a brother and sister and loving a stranger, an outsider, whether lost or evil, abusing you kind of person. And that is that we love the Christian phileo. That means we love him as Christ loved us, not just unconditional, like agape love. We love all people with agape. But the agape takes a special form with believers. So he says, especially those of the household of faith. So we do love them, but we love them in a phileo manner. That's why Jesus said to Peter, do you love me? And he used the word agape. Do you agape me? Then he said, feed my sheep. Then he said, do you love me? And he said, you're asking me the same question. But he wasn't. He changed the word. He said, do you phileo me? And that's when Peter didn't quite catch that. That he's saying, the way I've loved you is the way I want you to love your fellow man, you know, or the church. And so he was very clear about that. And so you can just trace that in the language and see why he was saying that. Yes, there's a difference. And no, they're all neighbor, because it's someone other than me. It's someone apart from me. But is my family apart from me? Well, in a way, husband and wife are one, but in another way, you know, and so on and so forth. So it gets complex, but actually, so if we don't dig into it any deeper than what I'm saying right now, the neighbor is everybody, but not exactly. Not exactly. There are specific scriptures that relate to different groups. And it's even more complex than I've said, because they have special words for believers who are this way and believers that are barely so. And, you know, they got all kinds of words that indicate this one is not this one. All right. So they are believers in the mercy of Christ. That was chair 4, because he shed his blood on Calvary for them. But they are not disciples of the Messiah as Lord. So they're under the Savior, chair 4, but they're not under the Lord, chair 5. And Jesus says to those who are his disciples, why do you call me Lord, Lord, and not do what I tell you to do? In other words, if you say Savior, Savior, I'll forgive you, because that's what saviors do. But lords don't do that. Lords command you. They tell you what to do because you're submitted to them. So if I'm your Lord, why don't you do what I tell you to do? And it's a great question, because that's the difference. So if one of the men in my church would be a whoremonger and he's brand new and he just got saved last week, I could forgive him. I could deal with him. However, if he's a disciple, I'm going to treat him very differently. Extremely differently. But I'm going to get that guy to be a disciple right away too. I mean, because unless you can see that person is still in the flesh, it's forgivable. He divorced, he did this, he did that, whatever it is. Okay, that's all forgivable. But you're not a new believer now. You're not a little child. You're now a young man, and pretty soon you want to be a mature father. So as a pastor, you have to have the ability to discern where is this person at any given moment. But you want everyone to aim in this direction. And it isn't hard. It isn't that complex. It's just you know who's submitted. So if somebody's submitted, they have to be disciplined. It's not like, well, yeah, it's okay. We just forgive sins. No, we do forgive sins, but we also want you to become a disciple because you are not going to stay a Christian for long the way you're going. And so you would have to then speak to that person who's in chair four still. You have to speak to them sternly. We don't do that here. And I'm very good at that. I like doing that to new believers. Hey, what are you doing? I'm just smoking. No, we don't smoke here. Well, no, we don't. And so, I mean, I've had some like that are, you know, off the streets, and we got them saved, and they're still smoking. So, no, we don't do that. So, don't. Do you have it? Are you clear? You know, so they realize, you know, I'm not treating them just like, hey, it's okay, we tolerate everything. No, we don't. Those are laws, and God's laws are they're for your good, for your happiness. It's because I love you, and I want you to be happy that I don't want you to be doing that. But I don't need to explain that. I just say it. Now, so what I was sharing there is believers should become disciples. 4 becomes 5. But I also would say that their sins, though they remain in chair 5, they're no longer ruling. They're no longer ruling. And that's what Mike, I know, I can hear his heart. He's praying that people here will not only listen to his words, but will actually start to submit to Christ as their Lord, voluntarily, happily, killing their flesh so that it's no longer ruling them and that they're really set free and they don't just go home and have arguments like they did before, whatever. Because, why? I know why, because he's experienced that himself, and he's learned you can be a Christian and still sin, and you can justify it. Chair 4. But you can't be a Christian and be serious without then, you can't say, no, I don't want to be a disciple. What do you mean? That's what it's all about. It'd be like a baby saying, I want to stay a baby my whole life. No. Every baby wants to be walking and talking and they watch you and they listen to you and they're going to copy you. And there's not a baby ever born saying, I don't want to do all that. I think I'll stay like this. The older child will do that. He'll want to revert because he sees the little kids getting all the attention. He'll start sucking his thumb to, I remember when I was the chief one here, you know, I was number one around here. I hate this other interloper taking my place. And so You do the same thing in the body of Christ. You have to keep people moving that, look, you're not 3, you're not 6, you're not 9. You know, you're different age, different responsibilities and different ways of treating them. Okay, so you can see that. And what's the fault? Why are people 4, 5, or 6 or whatever they are? Pastors, 100% guilt. Hirelings. A hireling will keep people in chair 4. So how do you build a big church? Be a hireling. Don't be Mike Balloon or Jim Borchert, because you're not going to have a big church, certainly not in the beginning. I mean, you can have a big church. Nothing wrong with a big church. But you can't have one in the beginning because you have to build up slowly, slowly, slowly. It takes a long time to build the church. Why? Because Jesus builds it. And he wants to build each brick exactly. And he doesn't want any, you know, gap between one brick and another. One, you know, so he's very good about shaping people. You don't do it. The pastor doesn't do anything. He's just talking. But Jesus does it. I will build my church, and the gates of hell will not prevail against it. So what's my purpose? I don't want the gates of hell to prevail against the believer. So I don't want to leave them here. I don't even want to leave them here. I want them to go here. Because it's very hard for Satan to get these. As a matter of fact, Satan will be the one that's trampled upon. And so when we get people here, they're basically immune to Satan. A man that's mature in Christ, remember Paul says, those among us who want to be perfect, you have to volunteer. I mean, it can't be something forced on you. The next one is 1 Peter 4:17 spells this out clearly. In 1 Peter 4:17, he tells us where all the problem is. It informs us that the social, economic, and political problems confronting us today are merely symptoms of churches not preaching the whole truth of the gospel and the second part of God's atonement. That's the problem, right there, churches. So here's what 1 Peter says. Those problems, economic, social, and political, are not the causes. They're not the causes of our problem today. They're the symptoms. They're just showing you that something's wrong in the church. The world is a reflection of what's good or bad about the church. When America first got started, the church was moving out of a bad church over in England, over in Europe, and those founding fathers were devoted to wanting to have a just government and to have a free church. And they did. But it didn't last long. It didn't outlast their deaths, basically. I mean, there were problems that showed up right away. And they began to divide against each other and so on and so forth. So they had a good idea, but they didn't know how to pull it off. You know why? Because it wasn't them. They couldn't do it anyway. They couldn't have solved it if they wanted to. Why? It's the pastors. And the pastors were all in their own denominations, fighting their own little territorial battles. And there was no way the Baptists weren't going to win, the Lutherans weren't going to win, the Catholics weren't going to win. You know, everybody was kind of unhappy with that thing as well. I don't know, you know. And so the churches never went on. You remember before the revolution, there was a man named Whitfield. And George Whitfield, he had a huge impact on the whole of America. And so he wasn't a Wesleyan, or he wasn't a Holy Club guy, or he wasn't whatever. He was a Christian. And even Ben Franklin was almost converted by him. And he used to give him money and so on to build churches, lots of them. Because he saw that's what unified America and made America great. So it was religion that played the major role. Nothing else. So it wasn't social, economic, and political. So our problem today is we've forgotten God, and all we got left is social, economic, and political. And even the churches. They haven't forgotten God like they still have the name of being alive, but they're dead. They have the name of being alive, but they're dead because they didn't go on. Why? They don't even know about it. The seminaries don't teach it. How could you learn unless you were taught? So since the church is now lukewarm, there's only a handful of people like Mike and others, crazy people, that actually are going for, you know, what it says in the Bible. And it's almost an advantage that he never went to seminary or to, you know, any kind of schooling, because otherwise he'd be brainwashed too. And it's very hard to escape it. You know that, Scott. It's hard. When you get into religion, it ruins you. It'll make your flesh, it'll save your flesh. It'll help your flesh to stay alive so you can do two things at once. You can be a Christian and a pagan at the same time. It's a wonderful thing. But anyway, just moving along, this thing of the social, economic, and political troubles today can't be solved by those people. But God isn't judging them. He is not judging them. He's only judging us and not the lukewarm. He's only judging us, the hot. So how many does he have? I don't know, but it probably is not very many. So it should be kind of easy for him to focus on just one small group like us. But you know what? Some individuals in this room probably have a lot of sin in them. That was a joke. You're holding back the whole group. So you know what? People do hang on to their sins for a long time. But if you ever get a body of people, small, two or three, God would be completely pleased. He would stop the whole world for those two or three. He won't defend a harlot church. He won't defend a hypocritical church. He won't defend fig leaf church. He's only going to defend a true church. But he will defend it. After all, it's his investment. He's not invested in those others. They long ago turned against him. So we're the same as the world. The world is worldly. The church is worldly today. It's a worldly church. Why? Because it is. He said it would be. And it is, just like he said. So this is our best day. Yes.
I was going to say that I think it's mainly worldly because they've jumped from chair 4 over to chair 7.
Yeah.
And said that Christ did it all.
Yes.
And it's just that the hireling.
Right.
Has either believed it or he's decided to teach it to gain.
Yep.
Status or whatever.
Right.
It may be.
Exactly.
But in the process, you lose a lot.
Right.
Of the ingredients needed to
right.
become the.
Perfect.
Right.
Yeah, no, you got it exactly right. If you jump from here, let's just say to chair 6, forget 7. If you just jump from there to here, this is millennium. If you just jump from there to here, you produce legalism. This is going to be legalism. Because even though you're looking loving and acting loving and really impressing a lot of people, you can make a big church out of this. As a matter of fact, they love it that you didn't go through this. Right here, they don't like this. And you'll have a church of 1,000 go down to 3. You know, you don't want that. So pastors know better is don't teach that. And the pastor himself is not. He couldn't be here or he'd be teaching this. So if he's not, he won't.
See, you and Mike are examples of men who rise up early, who commune with the Lord. I think that's another key element is the communing.
Yes.
The koinonia, the fellowship.
Totally.
With the Lord.
Right.
And he will begin to share.
Correct.
You know, I mean, being like Scott.
Yeah, exactly. See, you are the same. You rise up early and do the same thing you're just talking about. Because you saw something and that was just God. You didn't see Mike, you didn't see me. Because since we're dead, we're dead. And that's what you liked, is good. I saw Jesus. I don't want to hear him or see him. I want to see the Lord. And I'm the same way. I don't want to hear another minister. I this is the only place I come to. I would never go to another church. Why? Because I don't want to hear those ministers talk, hireling talk or whatever, because I would be correcting it every second. I mean, I would not be having a good time there at all. I couldn't do it. Hey, could I say something? You know, like Jesus ruined the first synagogue he went to in Capernaum. Remember, he stood up and he said, I'm reading this and this is being fulfilled today. You know, it's like they wanted to kill him right there. Let's kill that guy. So the pulpit committee that day decided he's out. You know, he's not going to get a job with us. Yeah. Yeah, right. Okay. So God is not judging them because he's interested not in any one of those. He's only interested in us. He's interested in those that are holy being perfected. That's all. Love being perfected. There's love here. There's love here. There's love here. But love isn't perfected till it's here. After death, after death, after death. That is the perfected love. So the Bible has all these categories. You can read them all. They're all there. Okay. So this 1 Peter 4:17 says this. Let judgment begin with Obama. No, doesn't say that. Let judgment begin with those crooked financiers, bankers, businessmen. Cheat and buy everything cheap. That was a joke. No, he's not interested in them. He's never going to judge them. I guarantee you he will not judge them. Because that's a fruit of our lack. We failed, therefore that's the fruit of that. They're the symptom of our refusal to worship God with all our heart and soul and strength and our neighbor as ourselves. That's the symptom right there. We caused that, not literally. But by not doing what you were supposed to do, there was no salt, there was no light, there was no truth, there was no gospel, not a full gospel. Well, therefore, those guys rose up. You can't now blame them for doing what you failed to do. That's why Jesus said to the Pharisees, whose picture's on this coin? Well, Caesar's. Okay, well then, render unto Caesar what is, because his face is on it and his inscription is on it. Whose face in inscription is on you? Who's on Caesar? God's face is on Caesar. His image and likeness is on Caesar. Of course, you get rid of it, he effaced it. But so what? He's going to be judged by that. So God owns him still. God never forgets. He never forgets, that guy never worshiped me. That guy did not serve me. Now, no matter how nice he is, how just he seems to be, he did not serve me. And he'll be judged by that someday. Yeah.
I was just going to say some of the things, and I haven't finished reading it yet, but some of the things you lay out in your book discuss how, you know, if we would operate in this way, how fortunate and blessed we would be.
Oh, total.
I mean, yeah, I don't know how you can get that out, you know, but I believe it truly needs to be heard by every senator, every congressman. I mean, because I think that they've made promises to the wrong crowds.
Right.
They've gotten tied up into the political, but the whole spectrum should have encompassed the people. It should be we the people.
Right.
And if they follow the things that you laid out in your book, then we wouldn't see all of these things happening.
It's true.
America would truly be a beacon on a hill.
No, it's totally true. You will never show to me any nation on earth that has justice that didn't have Christians in the foundation. So I just made a big statement that you can never show me any empire, nation, or people anywhere in the world. So when you have a few Christians just in the foundation, you could have a just government. How many? I don't know. But you have to have some because they're the light and they're the salt. And so the only one that can produce a just nation or have a revival now that could produce such a nation to go back would be if the Christians did it. You can't have somebody else doing it. It's got to be coming out of the churches. It's the church that's at fault. So let judgment begin in the household of God. It's God's house. You know why he's judging his own house rather than the world? He'll judge the world later. He has to have a standard by which he judges the world. Because they could say, if he judged them, huh, where was your thing? How'd your thing work out that you built? I don't think you got any further than we did, so I don't think we should be judged unfairly. And they could call on equity and have Jesus thrown out of heaven. Not really, but I'm just pointing out, God has to have a standard. Will he? Yes. And we're part of that. That's what's exciting is the harvest is ripe. It's only the laborers that are few. Just get a few. Anybody here could open a church in your home. You don't have to be a pastor. You don't have to have baptism and Lord's Supper and all those ordinances. You can make them really, really simple just to have fellowship, read the Bible without even having a full understanding. Just have some neighbors over and so on and so forth. Church is really easy to make. When it gets bigger and bigger and bigger, of course, you need to put it in order. Because you have 100,000 people, yeah, you can't do it that way. But God has that all worked out. You'll notice something. In the New Testament always went not to the countryside, but it went to the cities and went out from there. It's interesting that he went and saved a group of people out of the cities. And it often was a mixture of Jew and Gentile. But that's how it spread, rather than going to the country. You'd have a much better chance there of getting the whole countryside if it was only a village of 17 people. But that's not how he did it. He deliberately did it in the wrong way to prove it was God. All right, the next one is he's judging the whole house. So we who are members of his church, not those who are lukewarm, serious believers, born of the Spirit, filled with the Spirit, led of the Spirit, we who are called to be the salt of the earth, who are called to convict the world of men of their folly and wickedness. That's what salt is. We who are called to be the light of the world, that is to show unregenerate men the way to true righteousness by faith and truth, which is active in love, so that evil men may glorify our Father, which is in heaven. Matthew 5. That is so clear. And he laid this out from the beginning of his ministry, that he actually expected the church to be the light of the world. In other words, the only purpose of chair 6 is to get the world into the church. And they would start at 4 and, you know, start at 3, whatever, repenting of their sins and then move on. You know why? They will come in as converts. Why? With a fervor. Mike is like that. Mike was once a bad boy. And that's what made him when he converted so dramatic as, whoa, I have not lived good. And my story is the same. It's very powerful when a convert comes in, like Paul. Oh my gosh. Paul was, you know, he wouldn't let you go. He had no fear of the Jews at all because he knew them inside and out. He was the top, top, top guy of the Pharisees. And so he was bold and he's clear. But I tell you, a convert fights when he's being converted, and then he has to, then when he finally gets converted, he is gung-ho all the way. You can't stop him. He has no, you know, rules. He just goes, you are going to accept Jesus tonight. Choke you. But he'll learn quickly how God wants it. But God is not against people being fervent, even though it may be foolish and maybe not working. Yeah, still God okays it. I'm sure he winks at some of that. Saying, it's not so good. But we'll get to that later. But hopefully someone in the body of Christ is mature enough to notice that, pray for that person, and bring them in. But his normal way is to disciple people. That is the normal way you get people saved. And after all, they can be saved outside the church. And then you bring them, and then you disciple them in small house churches, however, doesn't matter where. It can be in a parking lot. It could be in a grocery store. You don't have to have a church, be formal. The state doesn't even care about these house church things. I don't know what to do if you have 20 cars out in front of your house, then they get nervous, you know. But if the whole town turned to Jesus, then the whole town would be the one not nervous. I mean, they wouldn't care. They would go, yahoo, the bars are closed down, the brothels aren't working, you know. They would be excited. And that has happened in America. That has actually happened in various places in Europe and so on. You read about those and it inspires you to realize, wow, there's no end to what we could have done. So now what God is saying, well, time's running out. You know, be a good time now to start. But you can't just call on that. It has to be made. Like, there's no way you could be other than on fire. There's no way. And that's what's happening to you. There's no way you cannot be on fire when you hear the truth, because it's killing your flesh. And when your flesh is dead, you're teachable. When your flesh is dead, you're teachable. Man. But it takes a lot to kill a person. Could anybody say amen? I mean, but once it happens, wow, it doesn't take a lot for that resurrected person to go and share with everybody the good news. Okay, so there we go. Next one. Individually, we Christians have failed to worship God our Father. Corporately, we have failed to be the glorious church as a bride without spot, parentheses, idolatry, without wrinkle, parentheses, fornication, or blemish, parentheses, loving this world, basically Ephesians 5:27. So those three sins are the sins, the major sins of the church today. Idolatry, adultery, it's called spiritual adultery, and then loving this world, love of this world, pride of life, all that stuff, as in 1 John. So those three are totally descriptive of the lukewarm church, and they're totally not descriptive of us, because we're not into idols. We're not into fornicating with kings, Revelation 17:2. We're not into loving this world, 1 John. So we don't love this world. We don't hate it. We hate it in the sense of it ruling. We don't hate the world itself. For God so loved the world means we love the world. But we're meaning by the world, by the way, that world is cosmos. The word is cosmos. It doesn't mean the world like the earth, haaretz in Hebrew. It means the world like inhabited portion of the earth, the place where people live, where they're building up cities and civilizations. And that's what it's talking about. Next one. Jesus is not coming back to marry a harlot church. He's coming back as Savior, Lord, and Bridegroom to marry a bridal church without spot, wrinkle, or any such thing. No idolatry, no adultery, no love of this world. Matthew 25:1, the harlot church is always composed of foolish virgins. So those foolish virgins of Matthew 25:1, those are the ones that aren't wise. But everybody here in this group, not perhaps literally, but basically, everyone here is a wise virgin. I want to be ready when the Lord comes back, and I want to be filled with the Holy Ghost. That's chair five. Baptism of the Holy Spirit is chair five. You need power in this world. If you ever try to live the Christian life without the power of the Holy Spirit, not going to work. You need God. You're wholly dependent on God to give you wisdom and power and favor and whatever else, all kinds of things that you need. Therefore, everything, this is a big statement, everything in the natural order of creation was, is now, and ever shall be wholly dependent on the Lord God. Everything. There's nothing in this world that isn't totally dependent on God. Nothing. And it can't even have existence without God. So there is no economy. There is no social order. There is nothing out there if you don't have God. No God, none of that. And the minute we would leave this earth, there'd be no earth. I mean, it'd be over. You don't understand. The whole world is depending on us. They're trying to kill us and get rid of us right now. But the truth is, we're their only hope. There won't be an earth. It'll be gone. It'll be dark, and God will judge the darkness, and it's over. Well, we know how it's going to end. But I want to talk about that. I want to talk about how it all ends. Because God made it to function properly according to His design and purpose. So you can't have a world that functions properly according to His design and purpose without God, including not just the natural order, but the inhabited parts of the earth when mankind first emerged. So when mankind first emerged, like let's say Tower of Babel, because we don't know anything before the flood. By the way, all we know is what's in the Bible. There's no evidence anywhere in the records out there that we could draw any big conclusions about how they exactly live. We have a few artifacts and so on, but you can't build much out of it. But after the flood, we can do it. After the flood, we can actually see civilizations, and they're in China, they're in India, they're in Babel, and so on and so forth. But all those Babel civilizations are always built on rivers, and they're always city-based, always. In other words, they go beyond hunting and gathering and fishing and all that kind of stuff, and they actually are doing agriculture, they have language, they have religion, they have everything, all the basic components that we have today. Nothing unusual, nothing different, nothing new. So there is no change at all. Babel is still with us today. And Baalism, which is the religion of Babel, is still with us today. Why? Because every religion is Baal. So every civilization is Babel. And this is a good point. Did you know that Abraham was looking for a city? And God told him, I will show you a city. He said, okay, where is it? He said, well, no, I'm going to show you. I'm not going to give you a map. I'm going to take you. Oh, okay, well, could you give me a hint? No. So Abraham just had to go by faith and leave, you know, his hometown. But he was in a city. He was in the major city of the day, Ur of the Chaldees. Chaldee is Kashtim. Kashtim is actually black-headed. Okay, so Cush. Cush means black in Hebrew. So he came from the black-headed ruled people, Sumer. But Ur is later than Sumer. That's back at the time of Nimrod. So when he started his little trek up the Euphrates to go to Haran, where his younger son had died, or his older son had died, Abraham didn't leave his family like he was supposed to do. He just stayed there until he died. The son died.
Father.
What?
Father. His father, right?
Whose father?
Abraham.
Oh, Terah. Yeah. That, I knew there was a father there somewhere. I knew it wasn't Father Abraham. And so when Terah died, that's because he hadn't left his family. Remember, he said, leave your family. So he finally left. Then he got to the promised land, and it was just a pile of rocks, and he said, I don't like this place. There's a big famine here. I'm going to go. First of all, I didn't go far enough. Now I'm going to go too far. I'm going to go down to Egypt, where there's nice stuff down there, and it's an easy life. and it's going to be awesome. Because I hear they have water down there and they got food and stuff. That's the place to go. How many know some Christians don't go far enough, others go too far? And so he goes down there and tells his wife, no, say that you're my sister and all this kind of stuff, and worked it all out. But the truth is that God had it all rigged, and Abraham wasn't always obeying God exactly what he was. The faith of Abraham doesn't have to do with his faithfulness. It has to do with his faith in God's faithfulness. I'm going to say that again. The faith of Abraham is not that he believed in his faith. He wasn't a faith teacher. The faith of Abraham was that he believed God would be faithful in a one-sided covenant. Where, remember, he fell asleep. Remember, he went and cut up all the carcasses and the birds came down and he kept fighting those things, wore himself out. And pretty soon God came down and cut the covenant and Abraham was snoring the whole time. So he never did, you know, do his part. The guy was asleep. It's like Adam. So how many know that God likes to do stuff in your sleep? And he gets full cooperation that way. He gets to do exactly what he wants to do without your help. Could I help? I'd appreciate it if you didn't. Just don't put your finger in this. Don't put your mark on this one. At any rate, this whole idea of the earth filling up with cities everywhere is as old as the hills. And all the history of time that we know for the last 6,000 years is all related to this. But, even before the flood. But there were no kings prior to the flood, no matter what you've heard. There were no kings, there were only patriarchs. So just like the Bible says, that's the way it was. And so the first king was Nimrod. But he wasn't just a king, he was a king of kings and lord of lords. Ah, guess what? That title's already been taken. How many know that Jesus wanted that title? Jesus wanted that title. So Jesus always gets his way. I don't know if you know that. Because the Father didn't like Nimrod taking that title. So he went down and, you know, messed up the language so they couldn't communicate. Do you know how easy that is? I mean, today we are not communicating here in America. I mean, linguistically, we're saying same words that sound similar, like, you know, justice. They mean, the other guys, something different than we mean, us, with the word justice or liberty or, you know, whatever. And so everything has been confused again, and we are back at Babel. And America today will not finish its destiny, its purpose, unless there was a revival among us. That's it. It's the only hope. And it can't be the lukewarm church. It's going to have to be us. So unless God wants to do that, and he may not want to. He may be ready to end this thing, you know, now. Like, hey, let's get this thing over with. Time of the Gentiles come to an end. Boom. He comes back. Boom. Married. Over. And I believe that's what's going to happen. I don't know about a revival or not, but if there were, that was what it would take. And I'm not sure we shouldn't be praying about that, is God. I know you could come back now and it'd be wonderful. But you know what? Maybe you still want to get some of those other people saved that are lukewarm and cold. Maybe we should be a church that's ready for that anyway, even if it doesn't happen. If you really worship God and love, because he still loves the world, for God so loved the world. So it wouldn't surprise me that that's something we should be praying about. Human civilization then, made by men, often arising in rebellion against God's heavenly purposes, nevertheless remains wholly dependent on God and therefore forever subject to his name. Whether men lean to their own understanding or not, whether men choose to remember and acknowledge his name or not, Babel and its proud towers and its descendant kingdoms, nations, and empires, which remain to this very hour, will therefore render a full accounting to their Creator, whom they chose to dishonor, and will be judged for all their works and rebellion, Genesis 10 and 11, until every knee bows and every tongue confesses that Jesus Christ is Lord, Romans 14, 11. So, all human life, all civilization, is subject to God and is wholly dependent on his initial and his ongoing continual holy presence, that's extremely important, that God's holy presence never leaves the earth, never. Loving kindness and mighty power, those three. Holy presence, loving kindness, same as the word for chesed, which means mercy. And his mighty power. Abraham knew him as El Shaddai, the powerful one. But he'll always be those three. In order to achieve their destiny and purpose. In other words, if the world today wants to achieve its purpose for which he created it and its destiny, it has to have a revival among us. There would have to be. There's no other way. There's no other possibility. For apart from him, this world has no existence and no meaning at all. All is vanity, all is evil, without God's will and pleasure. Natural life and human culture cannot survive without God. Now, there's not one leader in our world today that believes we need God, but they're wrong. So we know it. So we have to live it, not out to there, but just in ourselves until we become light and salt to this world. Today, the world is heading for its final catastrophe, final consummation, wholly oblivious to its coming judgment by fire. Because it never at any time worshiped the true and living God, never acknowledged his holiness, his mercy, his majestic power, even though there are troubles everywhere which men can neither comprehend nor control. So nobody today has any power to do anything. We're the ones he's trying to wake up. Wake, O Israel, right? Put off thy slumber. And not after them. He's not trying to, you know, do something with them. He's just showing you what happens when you let darkness take over. And it's in the church. Those three sins of idolatry, adultery, and loving this world, those three sins have to be repented of. And the church is not at all repenting. I don't think the altars are full today of Christians repenting, weeping, going before God, individually or as a body. And yet I think that's what must happen. I think the pastors are the ones not leading us. And so we have to have pastors that do that. All right. I could go on and on, but I've probably taken plenty of time to make my point. What is? The point is that we all depend on God. There isn't anything else but God. And we're the only ones that have this secret. The secret things belong to God. Deuteronomy 29, 29. The secret things belong to God, but the revealed things belong to us. Not just us as Christians, to every man, because they're revealed. But nobody's interested in those secret things that have been revealed. So the lukewarm church doesn't even know them anymore. They might know about some of it, but they're really not serious about it. They're wanting to love this world. They want the pride of life, and they want to have it both ways. I'm a Christian and a worldly person at the same time. I have a few favorite sins I want to keep. I don't blame them. They've got some really good sins that they're trying to keep, so they can still say Christian and yet keep a few sins. But God wants to eliminate them right here. But if the pastors aren't ready and if the churches aren't structured for it, how's it going to happen? Well, they're not ready and they aren't structured for it. So it's not going to happen except here. This is the place it can happen. Why? Because it's smaller. It's either in a home or it's in some building somewhere, rented or, you know, set aside. It doesn't make any difference. It doesn't have to be official at all. The official church is completely Laodicean, lukewarm, lost. You can't expect anything from them. They're not light, they're not salt. They're harlot, period. That's why he says, withdraw from the harlot. Revelation 18:4. Come away, pull away, withdraw yourself from them. Why? Because that harlot of Babylon is as old as, you know, Nimrod. And the harlot then is going to be the cohort of Nimrod. But what's going to happen? Nimrod throws her off. In the last days, which we haven't come to right now, but they're about to come to, and they'll be against it personally, but still, you got to love. You got to love. They call that love. Well, it's just toleration. And so what they're doing is selling their souls, right? But don't criticize them. They're not the light and the salt. You are. Pray for them. Bless them. You know, witness to them, share with them. You know, but don't do it just with words, do it with deeds. Die. So death, key to resurrection. Birth, death, resurrection. I love it. So I hope you're blessed today. Simple teaching, but profound. Don't expect the kingdom of God to be complicated. It's not. Worship and serve. Worship God, serve the neighbor. That's it. Loving kindness. As God has loved us, let us love one another. It's so simple. It's so powerful. But it isn't a matter of words. It's a matter of deeds. You know, it's not he who professes Christ. It's he who confesses. To confess something means to say the same thing as God does from the heart. If God speaks to you from his heart, then you must speak back to God from your heart, heart to heart. Religion is pure soul, body. Soul, body, psychosomatic. It's not heart. Ours is the only heart. It's intimate. It's passionate. It's all the way. But that's what God wants. So he wants us to be passionate today about his kingdom and his righteousness. And therefore, he will protect you, prosper you, keep you, and probably only the pastors will probably suffer. Probably you don't even have to suffer, probably. If you pray right, God, I know my minister is so dedicated. Use him as an example so I could watch. That would be a great prayer. But a better prayer from Mike's standpoint, my standpoint, would be if you prayed that, Lord, don't let it be Mike. Let me go first. That would be a great prayer. How many know you should pray for your pastors? You know why? It says so in the book. It just says so. I am definitely going to be in the first group that's persecuted, hated, and despised. Not a problem. I'm for it. I want it. I'm already pushing. I'm not seeing Goliath come down the hill and waiting for him. I'm going to run at him with all I've got. So is Mike. That's it. So that's what you want, is people that are bold, fearing not man, but fearing God. All right. God is great. God is good. Let us give praise unto God. Amen. Woo-hoo! Thank you. Any questions? I thought not. Oh!
I wanted to ask about, could you touch on the scripture? It just came to mind while you were talking the elect being deceived, deceiving is the very elect, false Christ. That was just coming to mind, you know, because I'm still stuck on number four.
Yeah. Okay, read it to me out of the scripture. Very carefully. You the exact words, and you'll see it may be a little different than what you think.
Okay. He said, for false Christ.
What scripture? What scripture?
This is Mark chapter 13, verse 22.
Okay, go ahead and read it.
For false Christs and false prophets will rise and show signs and wonders to deceive, if possible, even the elect.
There's the clue, if possible. So he didn't say, he just said, if possible. It's possible. But he didn't say that it would deceive. He just said, if possible. And what makes it not possible is this process right here, is you can't. As a matter of fact, as I just said, we're the ones that are going to aggress. We're the ones.
You can't skip from four to six.
Right. Yeah. That would be the one you could deceive, is someone that tried to go past five and go straight to six.
That takes the taking of your cross up and following him.
Right.
As a disciple.
Yeah.
Came to mind too, and how daily.
Right.
We have to. Climb upon that cross.
Right. Right.
So that the people at my job, I'm using myself as an example.
Right.
People I see at the restaurant or
sure.
whomever will see
Christ. Christ. Yeah.
You know, because Curtis is dead.
Yeah.
So that he can be led.
Amen. Yeah. Yeah. No. It's exactly right. It's powerful. And, you know, these are not our ideas or our decisions. These are really made by God. I mean, If you do a turn, it was God. The God did that. You can't give yourself, well, I kind of saw that, and then I decided, no. You decided, yes, but that was a response to something God had worked in your heart prior by His promises and by His Word. That Word works. It's powerful. Yeah.
Yeah, the world, don't know if I'm off track here, but the world, they go out of their way to try to explain away God.
Right.
From Discovery Channel has an onslaught.
Right.
History Channel
right.
has an onslaught.
Right.
Campaign almost.
Sure.
It seems to
right.
explain away. I mean, to call things of God alien.
Sure.
You know.
But that's what we want. You see, when things get hot, if you're not a six, you won't make it. And they're going to catch only the hypocrite who tries to go from four to six without going through five. But he won't catch the real person. It'll be just the opposite. Remember Philip? It was it Philip or who was the guy that got martyred? Philip.
Stephen.
Stephen. Stephen, when he got to what, you know, caught by them all and they were going to do something, gnash teeth on him and stuff, he actually started rejoicing. I mean, that's not natural. Even for a Christian, that's not natural. But he was so excited because he actually saw the Lord. I mean, supernatural right there. I mean, God actually showed him. Heaven opened, it said. He didn't make it open. It just opened. So God was just showing he was pleased with him. So he did die, but his death won Paul. Just too awesome. So, you know, how much do you, okay, let's put it this way. How much do you love your wife? How much do you love your neighbor? How much do you love what God loves? That's how far, you know, if you have the love of God, you have to love the Jews. If you have the God, if you have the Father's heart, you have to love wicked people. I mean, you can't just love the people you want to love. And so we're dead. That's why five is so important, because it's the death of you. The death of you is the life of you. When you lose your life, five, you find your life, six. This is not six, five, four. Four is not life. Four is the beginning of life, born. But now immediately I want to die so that I can live. Does it make any sense to the world? It makes total sense to us that if you actually lose your life, you find it. Because when you lose your life, you realize, well, I didn't have life anyway. That wasn't even life. That stuff stunk. That was no good at all. And you look back at your life and you realize, boy, I was dead before. I'm alive now. But you have to go through the suffering to prove it. If you don't go through the suffering, then you haven't been tested. When you get married and you come down the aisle and you've had no wounds on you, he's not going to accept you as a bride because he has wounds. But when you have the wounds on you and you come down the aisle, he goes, she looks just like him. They look perfect together. You see what I'm saying? The wounds, the suffering you've gone through, is the jewelry that the wife wears. The wife wears, just as Christ, the jewelry that he wears, because he went to the cross for you and made a name that was higher than any other name. That's why he had all that jewelry. So our only jewelry on the day of our wedding is how we went through chair five. That's it. Because then we produced all this. What we didn't do it. It was just because we were dead, then God lived and showed up through us, and he was seen. He got all the glory. That's good. Good question, though. Great question. So, yes, a Christian can be deceived, but I doubt that a mature Christian would be deceived, and that scripture doesn't say he would be. It just said, if possible. And it said, if possible, meaning it's probably not possible. But what he's saying is, just because you're a believer in chair four doesn't mean you won't suffer. But if you've gone through five and six, there's no need for suffering. You've already been through the suffering. That's why Philadelphia Church is our church. You're the Philadelphia Church. Why? Because it means phileo, the brother, Adelphos. Adelphos, phileo. Adelphus, Philadelphia. That's what it means. When you love the brethren, you've been through hell. You've been through whatever. To love another Christian, man, that's a killer. Right there. I mean, it's easier to love some guy in Africa that hates your guts or Al-Qaeda than it is to love a brother that's betrayed you when you were a brother, you went to the church together, and you I can't believe you're the one that did that.
So if I'm obeying all the commandments, the rich young ruler, then I'm a rich young ruler. And now the guy is saying, if you would be perfect, it's like, more money? That was his thought, is, you know, how could I get any more? But hey, whatever, I'm already pretty happy about this thing. God has come through for me. I obeyed all his commands, and forget that, you know, it was legalistic, but he did them all, and now he's rich. So this Jesus come along, and it kind of impressed him. Well, gee whiz, what do I have to do to get eternal life? I'd like that. Man, I've already got everything. I'd like more. So it's in all of us. I mean, that's just a natural thing, is that if you do bad, you should get punished. If you do good, you should be rewarded. It's just natural. It's just not Bible. It's opposite of the gospel. It's the opposite. God only forgives sinners. When does he forgive a righteous? Of course, he always means self-righteous. But when does he forgive a righteous? He said, I didn't come for the righteous. I came for sinners who repent. So there it is. So he's not really looking at wealth as being an indication of anything. If anything, if you looked at the Kennedys, it'd be a curse. You'd have to say that the wealthiest people are cursed. Paul Getty, or Jetty, whatever his name is. All those people... They have. I wouldn't trade my life for theirs at all. I don't want what they have, because it's all intrigue and, you know, horrible stuff. That's a rough world out there. I don't want that. I like the kingdom idea. I like that. If God be for me, who can be against me? I like that one. All right, you were going to ask. Oh, sorry. No. Go ahead.
I was thinking about Howard Hughes.
Howard Hughes.
I mean.
Yeah. Had everything.
Unbelievable.
Unbelievable. Yeah. It has not been a blessing at all. So it's very hard to see that they're happier in Highland Park than they are. And, you know, they're taking the drugs same as the people over here. They're doing all, it's horrible. Yes.
I like this, how you said to go towards, like David and Goliath, to go towards them, and then the Lord will protect you. That was cool. But
right.
In repentance, you said repentance means the total opposite.
Yes. Yes. Thank you. Sorry. Okay. The word in the Greek is metanoia. Meta, M-E-T-A-N-O-I-A. And that means to change my mind. So that's what everybody thinks. Now I'm going to define that. They think it means stop sinning and start doing what's right. Everybody thinks that's what repentance means. Turn around. Stop what you're doing. You are so bad, you need to stop what you're doing and start doing what God wants you to do. It's not what it means. Not what it means. But the Hebrew word is nuach. N-U-A-C-H. It'd be spelled in many ways, Noah, and so on. But the easiest way to understand it is Esther. Esther, it was said, after Purim, that they had finally been vindicated from their enemies, said, and so the people had rest. The people had rest. That's nuach. The word right there is nuach. In other words, they had a time of celebration, rejoicing, happiness, peace, and comfort. And if you'll read the word for comfort ye my people, Isaiah 40. If you read that word, nuach. So if you read the word nuach in the Hebrew, repent means not stop sinning and start doing what's right. It means you can't do what's right. God has already done what's right. Enter into his rest. Enter into Shabbat. Enter into no labor at all. Jesus said it this way, come unto me, all you that labor and are heavy laden, repent. Come unto me, all you that labor and are heavy laden. I will give you rest. Peace, joy, happiness, worship, Shabbat. Perfect. Perfect. Yeah.
I have a question that my grandson asked me this morning. I tried to make it clear because it was the morning in the scriptures that was raised up. It said, judge not or you shall be judged.
Mm.
You know.
Right.
And it goes on down the line, and I was telling him of some of the portion, but I'd like to hear what you think about that. And then righteous judgment.
Right. Okay. Judge, the judgment you judge on somebody else, you sinned, you don't deserve my love and mercy. Okay, that judgment, forget what the specific is. You did wrong, so therefore it's right for me to hate you. It's right for me to punish you, and it's right for me to cut you off. That's the way most Christians think, is the reason I'm hating you is because what you just did was wrong. You did a bad thing. So the judgment you judge, then you'll be judged by that because God sees that was your standard, which you claim God did. But God never did that. He loved people that didn't deserve it, people that rebelled against him, people that hated him and killed his son. That's the one he loves. That's the one he forgives. So God is the opposite. If you do wrong, I will still show you mercy because I don't desire the death of any sinner. So his understanding of judgment is don't judge others because with the same judgment you just judged, you'll be judged. It'll eat you up. You cannot hate other people and despise them and look down on them and not have it affect you. It doesn't affect them as much as it affects you. You just destroyed your life. Making judgments is different than judging. When I make a judgment, I go, you committed murder. Fact. When I judge you, I go, you murderer. Now that one is me looking down on you, hating you and despising you for doing it. So that's what he's talking about. With the judgment, you judge. Why? Because only God is allowed to make a judgment. He knows the heart. He knows the soul. He knows the hidden things. He knows the secret things. You are not allowed to make that. You don't know good and evil. Never make a judgment unless you hear God's judgment, like Jesus did with the adulteress. He said, neither do I condemn you. Go and sin no more. He knew she'd sin. He just said it. Go and sin no more. Don't do any more sinning. Don't keep this up. Not because she was or wasn't. She may have gone right back to it. We don't know. But what he was saying was, I didn't judge her. My father did. Neither do I condemn her. Why? Because my father didn't. He heard the Father first, because the judgment, and it says this in the Bible, that a judge should never make a judgment. He should always make God's judgment. So then it's tzaddik, a just judgment, okay? So tzaddik means that it has to be a perfect judgment, not just a judgment like, here's the sentence I give. You're going to die or you're going to live. But it's a just one, so that it's mesharim, with equity. I'm judging you with the equal judgment, the equal standard. In other words, if there's a standard by which is right and wrong, which is God, I'm going to judge you with God's standard, and he can forgive sinners. So therefore, I don't know whether he's going to judge you or not, because I got to check with him. And if he says you're guilty, you're guilty. If he says you're not, you're not. But that's up to his mercy. And what if she relied upon the mercy? What if she actually looked to Jesus for mercy? And he then asked the Father, Father, do we give this woman mercy? He said, that's why I sent you. That's your mission, by the way. And so, yes, we do forgive her, even though she's a sinner. And we know she committed adultery. She's got witnesses galore here. But you got rid of all those witnesses. You know why? He got rid of them because if he had judged her, he had had to judge all of them, and all Jews would have been dead. There'd been no hope for the world. Just judgment. So always judge with just judgment means the one God gives, always mitigate with equity, always mitigate with mesharim. So there's a word for mishpat, that's a judgment. But a tzaddik mishpat is a just judgment. But if mesharim makes that judgment just because of the mercy of God, that would be true justice. And that's the one that Jesus gave for the woman caught in adultery. Three different Hebrew words. Mishpatim, mishpat, or mishpatim, that means plural. Mishpat is a judgment. I, the judge, make this sentence. Tzaddik means it's a righteous judgment or a just judgment. That's justice. But mesharim means, and it's equal to the judgment by which I would judge everybody. Same standard. God's standard. What is it? Law? Or gospel. So you'd have to decide. I know you're not going to say that to your grandson, but you have to do that. All right. I love you all.
Love you.
You're the best. You're the best. Beloved of God, please go to chair 5. It's so comfortable. It's like the electric chair. Huh? It's like the electric chair. This one's like one of those lazy boys. Very comfortable. That one is, that's a lover chair.
The Lord bless you.